go.
Finally made it to the mall. 6 hours later.
That's why you don't see this place growing up, because of Graham. After the fighting of Sodom and Gomorrah.
Sell out the whole group from the extent of experience. So then
Jumbo!
Jumbo!
No, we're supposed to do it at the same time.
Okay, right. Try again. 1, 2, 3.
Jumbo!
Can't you have to do it like silently?
Okay.
Just like,
Jumbo. What's up, y'all? We back. Guess who it is?
It's down with the Browns.
And we got a new word for you. The new word is what?
Jumbo.
Jumbo. And you know what Jumbo means? In Kenyan, it means hello. So you just saw the teaser right there. We just went to Kenya. I think we spent about a week.
Yeah, we were there for 7 days from Sunday to Saturday. And we split our time between, well, just like 1 or 2 days in Nairobi, and then the rest we spent in
all of this safari in the Masai Mara on the National Reserve. You know, we saw elephants, we saw kangaroos, we saw giraffes, we saw lions, we saw leopards. We're just gonna talk about the whole trip and the whole shebang right here and the whole breakdown of our whole trip to Kenya. So we want y'all to sit back, relax, enjoy. Also, subscribe because we're on
like and subscribe.
Like and subscribe. We're on our road to 500. And then other than that, you know, we'll break down the whole trip. We hope you enjoy it. Get down with the Browns. Okay, so how do you get to Kenya? First thing y'all do, number one, is have a passport. Number two, get a visa.
And number three, you have to either have a vaccine or get a COVID test within 72 hours of arrival.
The visa process, pretty simple. I'll put the website on the bottom of the screen. I think it's kenya.evisa.go or something like that. I think it costs like $51. All you gotta do is just quick selfie of yourself, upload it, some other information, and within 2 days it comes back to you.
Yeah, and you get an email. Now, we kind of messed this part up. I think once we got the email, we were supposed to log back in and print out some page. I don't know. Literally everybody else had it except for us, but we showed them the confirmation email and they still let us in, but we still had to like get out of line. It was really awkward.
Maybe it took an hour, 45 minutes to get out of the airport.
What's up, y'all? We made it to part two. Welcome to Kenya.
Yeah.
And then once we got out of the airport, because the first time we landed in Nairobi, we just had the hotel pick us up. Later on, we learned Uber, hey, when it comes to technology, Kenya is like in the forefront compared to other, I guess, African countries. So you could have took an Uber, but the hotel picked us up. We stayed at the basic Sheraton.
The Four Point Sheraton in Nairobi in Hurlingham.
About to get our first Kenyan breakfast.
Yum, yum, yum.
Time to eat.
Maybe like 35, 40 minutes from the airport,
yeah.
But we're more in the center of Nairobi. And so that's where we stay. And then the next day, we figured, hey, Uber seems pretty strong here. Let's take an Uber.
Using the Uber in Kenya. Oh, this guy's driving on the wrong side. Hello. We're heading to this giraffe center. Should be good. Spend a few hours here.
Scucho.
Brother.
Huh?
What's up?
What about the charger?
Oh, you got everything,
iPhone
huh?
Type C. You switch one.
No, I don't need one. I'm good. Thank you, though.
Yes, so the Giraffe Center, you know, everybody's seen the Giraffe Manor, you know, whenever, like, the giraffes poke their head into the window.
And with the IG chicks, you know, you having breakfast with a giraffe on them and all that stuff. Yeah.
That was way too expensive.
1500 nights there over there.
In the morning, the giraffes are in Giraffe Manor, and then in the afternoon, they come to Giraffe Center. So that's where we went, and it was like,
it was
$20.
Cool. I mean, it was like I said, about a 15-minute Uber. Yeah. We got in the Giraffe Center. I'll cut to some shots.
Okay. Yeah.
Do it again.
Did you get it?
You got it.
Did you get it?
You could feed the giraffes with, I think you feed them like alfalfa pellets. The alfalfa pellets, they come up to you, they eat, they have this big, long tongue that actually looks nasty, but when they're actually feeding you, it's kind of like soft, it's pretty cool.
Robin feeding this guy, his tongue is so blue, it's crazy.
Maybe we're there like 30 minutes.
Yo, I want to
Also, when you're done seeing the giraffes and feeding the giraffes, they have a guy inside. How many giraffes are there in Kenya? Four giraffes?
So there's three types of giraffe. There's reticulated, Rothschild, and
the Maasai.
Yeah. And we mostly saw the Maasai because of the area. I think you have to go further.
Maybe north or south to see, but we saw the Maasai because we were in the Maasai. Then, after we feed the giraffes, we go in, there's a little learning center, and there's a guy giving a speech about how the center works. He's telling you all the types of giraffes. We sat in that speech for maybe about 10, 15 minutes.
Yeah, because it was good to hear how they were trying to increase the
numbers.
Because
they were dwindling poachers.
Yeah, they were starting to get endangered, and so it's almost like a sanctuary.
Nice little
experience.
Quick, fast, fun, feed the giraffes.
And go to delicious
Fanta soda
flavors that you can't find in the States. Passion, and it's delicious.
Passion fruit, off to the next place.
And then after that, we hopped in another Uber. This Uber driver was chill, playing us local jams. I learned a new local songs, and we went to the Karen Blixen house.
Yeah, the Karen Blixen house. So if anybody's familiar with the movie or the book
Out of Africa,
it was just really cool. This was her home when she lived in Kenya, I think even her second home, but they preserved it really well. And you can see her furniture, her bed, her dishes, her clothes. Everything is just really well prepared. Preserved.
You're thinking about food. But I don't have many shots here because they didn't really let you like take a camera inside, but I think it was $20-$25, but definitely worth it if you have time to spend in Nairobi. Obviously, there's also a gift shop. We started buying some gifts. We'll talk about that more later, but it was just cool to see that well preserved. And she also did a lot for the community when as far as sickness and helping. And she was trying to grow coffee plants, but coffee did not grow in that environment. So all of her investment was kind of just going into the ground and just was really panning out. But that's what she was there for. They made the movie. And then once that movie came out, I think in the 80s, there's a lot of Kenya tourism picked up.
Yeah, so check out the movie or the book if you're a reader. But then also if you're in Nairobi, definitely check it out. We both enjoyed it. He had never heard of that.
I never heard of it
before. And he still found it.
It was cool. So now, after we did our first day in Nairobi, we always like to book a day in between just in case things go wrong as far as flights. So the next day, which actually was Monday, we would be heading out to the safaris. So there's two ways to get to the safaris. Now you all know me already, T-Bro don't like to stay on them little baby planes, so we actually took
The slow bus.
The slow safari vehicle.
Safari van is ready to go.
We went by car.
By car.
Lean back a little bit. You know, lean back. Hey, there it is.
Low riding as we head to Imbo River.
Yes, we're heading to the Maasai Mara. But you could also go by plane. It's a lot faster. I think if you go by plane, it's maybe like 2 hours or less. But we went by car in the safari vehicle, and it took us...
We left late.
Like I think 8 a.m.
Yeah, 8 a.m. and we didn't really get to the safari of the Maasai Mara where we were going. until about 5:30. But there's a lot of stuff that went in between that. So, but when you are on your way, we do have to, we had to stop at the Great Rift Valley.
Thank you.
All right, this is the Great Rift Valley viewpoint. Just made it here.
Yeah, and that was beautiful.
That was beautiful.
So you
yeah.
could just see, it was so vast. And so even though it was the slow route, we got to meet a lot of the people along
Correct.
The way. So that was actually pretty cool.
Here we say Jambo. Jambo is hello.
Mm-hmm.
Karibu is welcome.
Yeah.
Asante is thank you. Hakuna Matata is no,
no problem,
from Lion King movie.
Yep.
But of course, if you're like on a short time frame, then just...
You may want to just fly out there, but when you're on the safari bus, you take as much time as you want, you take as much luggage as you want. We had no issues. We stopped, we got food. What was the first city we stopped in after the Great Rift Valley?
I think it was Mahi-Mahu.
Mahi-Mahu?
Oh,
snack center.
Wait, I don't think I dipped in.
Oh.
Wow.
My friend, you also have a
look here.
Yeah,
oh, yeah.
You also have a breakfast here.
All kind of food, huh? Okay.
Some local girls served us what? Plan? No, it's not plantains.
It was, they called it Kenyan donuts. I don't know if that was the real name for it.
We also got samosas. Samosas are big out there. We're not in India, we're in Kenya, but samosas are really big out there.
All right,
samosa, mandazi, na chapati.
And we went to the local shop and shopped.
Yeah, and that was really great. Again, when we were just talking to the people while we were waiting for the food, they were like, cousins, welcome back.
And yeah.
Well, they said me cousin. They said he was too.
They said I was too light-skinned. But they say Robin had the build of a, I guess, African woman.
She has an African booty, huh?
Yeah, you know,
not booty, body.
But we got some goodies. I don't know if you can see this. You probably can't. There we go. We got these little elephants, he's made it all the way back. And then also, you know what this says, Hakuna Matata.
Hakuna Matata?
Hakuna Matata.
Hakuna Matata.
Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata.
I don't even know how much we bought, but all the artifacts made it back. We got some little-
Artifacts? Souvenirs?
Souvenirs, all the souvenirs made it back. And we probably spent like $300 or $400 in these shops and buying all these goodies, but at least it's going back into the community. And the guy was a good salesman. We just kept buying more and more and more. But all in all, it was good.
Yeah.
And that was maybe, we left at 8, probably were there around 10:30.
Yeah.
And then we started driving, going towards the safari, the Masai Mara. The next big city we stopped in was Narok.
Yeah. So Narok was a cool place because it was like the, it seemed like an economic center. There was a lot of like, there was like
big grocery store.
We actually got luggage there because
she bought too much stuff.
Bought
I had to buy some more luggage.
But it's really cute. But they had everything in this grocery store. They had luggage, they had fridges, they had microwaves.
TVs, microwaves.
It
you
was
know?
Like, I don't know, maybe a Costco, but like in regular grocery.
After we left Nara, I think it was like around 12, 1 o'clock-ish. And then like, I'm like, dang man, how much longer we got? And then all of a sudden it was like, kaboom, 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 we got a flat tire.
I have a few shots,
we got a flat tire.
We got a flat tire out here. Uh-oh.
And then the guy's jack didn't work. So man, we was jacked on the side of the road for like at least an hour. Some other guy came by in a safari vehicle and he let us use his jack. We got it back up and going, and then we were back on our road. By that point, it would have been about 2:30.
Yeah.
And then we had like another 3 or 4 hours out, but then we finally made it to Masai Mara.
Finally made it to the Mara. 6 hours later.
So we took the option of going to two different safaris because we wanted to have like the different experiences of going to like the same in the Maasai, which is a reserve that's owned and operated by the government, and then staying in a conservancy, and that's more
privately owned land and
less regulated.
And one thing is, when you're on the reserve, like that's owned by the government, you can't get as close to the animals. So you might see when the first stop was at Umpu River, we couldn't really go off of the road, but when we were at the next place, which was Kapinski, we could just, we just going all over the
all
place.
All up in those animals' faces.
Oh man. Okay, buddy. Keep moving.
Yeah, so that's one thing to know.
And then the other thing is, again, to sort of diversify our experiences, we stayed in one of the safari lodges that we stayed at, or safari camp, was an eco-friendly
lodge,
like zero carbon footprint, and then the other was more traditional. So we had an electric vehicle at the first one, and the second one was
gas
it up.
Oh, you know, just going everywhere. You know, good old Toyota Land Cruiser. But other than that, if you don't know how safaris work, how safaris actually work is, you book them and you're there all day, or you book them for 3 days. Yeah, they cost a lot of money, but that comes with food, that comes with your transportation for the game drives, that comes with snacks, that comes with all the other
laundry,
all those extracurricular activities. So what would happen was, in the morning, you'd wake up at maybe 6:30 a.m., you'd have some tea, some coffee, some biscuits, you're meeting all the local people there, you go out for a morning game drive for maybe like two and a half hours
yeah,
while the sun comes up. And then after that, you can either have something they call a bush breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
So a bush breakfast is you just eat it out there, and then with your other people on the tour, and then they're making your breakfast. And after that, you can have a couple hours where you just chill, you do a massage, or you went back at the lodge.
Yeah, at Ember River, you could do a tour. You could do an eco tour to learn about how sustainable the property is. You could also just like take a nap if you're, you know, tired.
The next day, we actually did a Maasai village tour walk. So we did that. We can talk about that though. Back to how safaris work. You got the morning drive, and then you come back and chill, then you have the evening drive, then you eat dinner, then you just do it all over again. So that's kind of like why they're so expensive.
Yeah, and there's just a lot of staff involved. So you have all the people that are serving you in the restaurant, then you have the chef, you have your room attendant, you have the manager of the like the safari lodge, you have the drivers, the guide. So there's just like a lot of people involved in helping to make sure you have a great experience. And so that's why it's so expensive. But I mean, honestly, it's a once in a lifetime experience.
Correct. That's
totally
why we did it. I'm not doing it again, unless y'all fund me. Okay. By the time we got to Embu River, it was like, what, close to 5:30. And I was like, we're gonna miss our first game drive. So as soon as we get there, it's like, hey, yeah, we're gonna try to accommodate you guys. We'll go out for a game drive, or it's called a sundowner.
It's crazy. We finally made it.
So we went out there for a sundowner, and then you kind of like, they bring some food, some snacks, and then also you just watch the sun go down.
Yeah.
Sunset.
That's a good
one.
Yeah, yeah.
Here in the Maasai.
And then at Embu River, we stayed in a place called the Lion's Den.
Ooh.
It was the Lion's Den. Let me tell you that.
Open up this, see who's inside. Oh, look who's just sprawled out. This is the room.
Yeah.
Looks like she's just over here.
Taking a break.
A shower over there. Some lights and music playing. Real toilet. But yeah, this is the spot.
So, first I just want to say, if you're an outdoorsy person, I think this would be perfect for you.
Yeah.
We are not really outdoorsy people. It sounded nice in theory, but like we were in a tent. Like
basically
no doors, no walls, no windows. I mean, there was running water.
Yeah.
But like it was a tent.
It was a tent right next to this hippo pond, and at night these hippos would just fight and make all of these noises.
But again, everybody else seemed fine with it. Yeah. So it was
I'm bougie.
Count me as bougie, but it was definitely an experience.
I think a baboon ran over the top of the tent.
Yes.
We heard so it was scary.
Last night, I'm not gonna lie, I didn't sleep. All I heard was noises.
Hyenas just laughing and hunting all night, you know, like, get you. But the first morning while we were there, I'll cut to some shots that I do have from this place. We saw some hyenas that were hunting. Yeah, it killed some sort of thing.
I think they had gotten a toady. Uh-huh.
We also saw a leopard that first day.
Leopard. Like the curly tail. Wow.
But other than that, just riding around, just four-wheeling, just seeing what we can see. Like I said, you're in the conservatory, so you can't go as wild. But what is cool, though,
on the reserve.
But what is cool is you can request, hey, I haven't seen an elephant, I haven't seen a giraffe, I haven't seen a wildebeest, or whatever you want to see. And so then those guides were actually like, they kind of know where they were at. So when we were on the reserve, it's like, hey, the next second day was like, we wanted to see an elephant and we wanted to see a giraffe.
Mm-hmm.
So man, we may have drove like 2 hours. It was like an hour and a half. I don't know where we were at. Like, we just going over planes, just going out, just going out, just going out. All of a sudden, bam.
How about giraffe? That's a mama now.
So it just so happened that where we were staying on the reserve hadn't rained in a while, so a lot of the animals had moved on. So you might see onesie, twosie, because a lot of them had gone further.
They have migrated to where greener pastures were, where there was more rain.
It's like not happening, it's something right now.
Because we went, like I said, we went in February, so the rain season is about to hit, so everything is pretty much dry right now, so the animals have to migrate with the water and the food, which kind of makes perfect sense. No knock to them, it's just where they are located at the time.
Yeah.
But for the most part, it was cool. We saw the animals that we wanted to see. And then after that, we went to the Maasai village.
Yes, so we went and visited with the Maasai people. We got to see their homes. And they were so welcoming and opening. We got to meet the chief.
Okay.
Jumbo!
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 And he didn't speak English, but our guide
had a translator for us.
Yeah, we had a
chief. So the chief asking, which country are you coming from? Canada?
Canada.
America.
America. Canada.
He could ask us questions, we could ask him questions, and they were just super friendly. Oh, and they taught us how to make a fire.
We made a fire like I tried doing it with sticks. I can cut to what I have, but they got the fire going. I couldn't do it. We went in a little tent, the little home.
Roasted meat, boiled meat, and also we used some medicine from a bush.
They came out, they danced for us. If you see them jumping, that's kind of a ritual that they do when it comes to, I guess, going for a mate or a wife.
Just how you attract a wife.
Women. But they sang for us, we danced with them, all in all. Then on the backside of the village, there were some kids playing soccer, got some shots of them, as well as just some shopping. So we always like to do some shopping. Then you also was just bargaining too, like, oh, I want to pay this much, you pay this much.
Yeah.
We did some local shopping, and then we went back to Imbu River for like the game drive. One thing we found out when we got there, I didn't even though I booked it, I guess I didn't read the details. They had no meat at this camp. So if you wanted meat, you had to request the day before. So sometimes we got some meat, sometimes we didn't, just matter if I requested it. And the food was all, was it vegan?
Yeah,
yeah, all vegan. Like, yeah.
It was vegan, but it was beautiful.
Vegan, but beautiful food.
Yeah.
But other than that, I was Imbu River. It was cool. It was chill. Oh, also one thing we did at Imbu, another reason why we went was we planted a tree.
Planting this tree, huh?
Okay. So.
So that was one thing we wanted to do. We wanted to leave our mark. So we both planted a tree at the camp. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, just trying to give back to the land that, you know, that we were taken from, you know?
Yeah.
So we had, the next spot we went to was Kapinski.
Kapinski, yeah.
Kapinski. And the Maasai Mara, boy, this place was nice, boy. As soon as the dude came and picked me up, he's in his uniform, I saw some binoculars waiting in the little safari truck, some sodas. As soon as we started leaving, because the geography started changing, as soon as we got off the reserve, like now all of a sudden we can start seeing different animals.
What's up, man?
And so when you're kind of getting transported between two different safaris, that is also like a small
game. That's a small free game drive. Not free, but it's another game drive.
Nothing's free. And Alex, our driver, he was amazing, super, just, he was like, boom.
Got you. As soon as we came in, we saw a herd of elephants. You know, I'm like, what? I saw all these baby elephants, big elephants. Because the landscape changed. Maybe it was like an hour and a half, 2 hour drive to get to the next spot that we were going to, but hey, we saw elephants. I was like, oh man, could we see some giraffes? Giraffes just out there just strolling. I'm like, hey, look at them. Look at them.
And at the tip of the horn, there's a lot of hairs.
And most people aren't like searching for
these animals, but we hadn't really seen them. Like, I'm paying all this money, I ain't seen nothing yet. Give me a refund.
Oh man. But like the main, so they call them the Big Five. So the Big Five, these are like the animals that are the biggest predators. And so it is the lion, the leopard, the rhino, the buffalo, and the elephant.
Those are the ones that were like sought after, I think, from back in the day. Real quick, no rhinos in our area. You have to go somewhere else. Rhinos are pretty much almost extinct.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
We wasn't expecting to see rhinos, but we did see the other four all the time.
Yeah.
We saw all these elephants. We saw elephants. We saw giraffes on our way to the new Camp Kapinski. And then as soon as we got there, man, these guys are like singing for us. I'm like, we get out of the truck. We got everyone out there just welcoming us with like with song and dance.
Hello, Jim.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm good.
Dominic.
I'm feeling good, man.
I have some shots I cut to it. I was like, man, this is nice. Now, that could have happened at Imbu as well, but because we showed up so late,
yeah,
everything was just kind of messed up. But when you show up on time, you know, you could shoot it right on time, you know?
Okay. But we could, as soon as we drove up, we saw the difference. And that's it's no shade to Embu River. They were different experiences. But as soon as we walked into Kapinski, I mean, there's like hardwood floors,
yeah,
and a lobby.
Jumbo.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Most welcome.
Thank you.
Everything was just so beautiful. Dominic, the camp manager, he
checked us in. I gave him my card. I said, charge it, man, until it don't work. And he said, okay. So he checked us in, and then he walked us down to the room. I have a shot of the room. I think I took on my phone. I'm just gonna cut to that right now. I was just blown away. I was just like, wow.
Which hotels or camps? Now we're at the Olari Kapinski. What's up? What's up? What? Look at this room. What? Look at us just chilling. Super king bed over here. What? Bathroom, tub, that's what I'm talking about. Shower, toilet, safari life.
This is nice. It's like this 1920 kind of like style,
yeah,
but still modern day. It just has this old vintage look that, like, hey, you see in the movies like Born Free or I guess Out of Africa. And they keep that kind of like vibe going throughout the whole safari slash resort. So that's what was really cool. This had running water, everything was hot. Like, we had like real room as far as we could close the windows,
yeah,
and no,
like, it had
doors
and wall. Well, it was still a tent, but
yeah,
again, it had hardwood floors. I mean, it was just really nice. It just looked like a regular hotel room.
And then Robin got a massage. We washed some clothes, and then, oh man, we had Chef, what was his name?
Chef Bernard,
boy, his brother could cook, you know, like, he was making all of the meals, he'd come out there, and then after you eat, like, how you doing, do you like the food, and all this other good stuff, but yeah, it was no complaints. And then in the evening, we went for our first game drive. We shared the truck with another couple.
Yeah,
but
on
yeah,
their honeymoon,
but it was
from Mexico.
But this first game drive, man, it was just night and day, like, but we left at like, what, 5 o'clock? We didn't come back till it was like pitch black, but we just started seeing, what was it, lions the first day?
Yeah, we saw like an
abundance of lions.
Like a whole pride, two different prides actually. We saw two different prides of lions. We saw cheetahs. And we were like, Reach out,
touch. There was one
like,
point.
Yeah,
we don't touch. Like, but the lion is just coming at you. I have a shot where he was just roaring. And we're just kind of like, as soon as he gets past you, then he starts up the car. And,
yeah.
Then we go around and get another shot. And he's just coming through. And then also, we also saw three cheetahs. We hadn't seen any cheetahs this close. The cheetahs had just been kicked out of the home from the mom. So they were out on their own. They were young and they were trying to hunt themselves. So we saw these cheetahs were right there, just driving around, seeing them. They're just strolling past you. I'm just like, man,
they were so beautiful.
Yeah.
So beautiful, but you could tell that they just hadn't quite built up their skills yet.
Yeah.
And then they also sort of noticed that there was like a lion pride in the distance, so they had to move.
Move, because the lions were hunting the cheetahs because they knew they were babies. So we didn't see any like chase, but we did see a lot. We got a lot closer to the animals. Shout out to Dominic. Then we came back at night, the first days at night. And then, oh, my bad.
Dancing.
Shout out to Dancing. Dominic do work there too, though. We came back at night. And I'm like, man, this guy is crazy. He cut off the lights. We just driving around. And like, it was just so much fun. And that was just day one. I was just like, wow.
Yeah.
So then the next day, the next morning, you know, you wake up, go for a morning game drive. I think we saw more lions again. Different pride, though.
Yeah. So after we finished our morning game drive, we went out on a bushwalk.
Bushwalk, that's what it was.
And it was like all fun and games at first. And then like...
Until I walk outside, I see the guy with a gun. I was like, okay, this is serious.
Yeah, so one guy had a gun, the other guy had a spear. And we're like literally just
walking in the bush.
In, like bushes.
In the middle of a bushwalk, literally in the bush.
And then as soon as we're like maybe... I don't know. Maybe
120
like
yards away from the camp. Look
yeah,
out.
We see a lion.
Just like, chilling.
And we're on foot.
Yeah, I was just like, this guy's gonna come get us.
And we're like, what do we do? Like, what do we do?
And it was just unfazed. You know, we just still, he's showing us how they use some of these plants that they use were like for toothpicks.
That's why you don't see these trees growing up, because of graft.
Ah. Yeah. Ah, because the giraffe is stopping them.
Yeah.
It gets as high as a giraffe neck. Okay.
Yeah.
This? It's a toothpick.
He's just walking around. He has his spear, just explaining different things about the nature and how the Maasai people use that in their everyday life.
Yeah.
We saw some, we went to a hippo. We saw some hippos.
Yeah.
On a nature walk. And we just took some pictures. But other than that, yeah, the nature walk was cool. Like, man, no complaints, but it was a little scary just knowing that lion was out there because there was a pride right behind the camp.
Yeah.
And so, like, he was just free.
Because you're like, I mean, for both camps, like, you can't walk around unattended.
So correct.
For both of them, for the first one at Embu River, like, if you want to leave your tent, you have a flashlight.
You got a flashlight.
And so you, like, kind of flash someone and hopefully someone comes to help you. And then for the second one, there was a phone. And so you're never supposed to go unattended because there's literally animals walking around and not just like, oh, you know, lions, cheetahs, leopards, baboons, like things, you know, creatures that could really hurt you. So just know that you're in the wild.
You're in the wild, and then when you come back from these camps, then one night, they like to do little surprises. One night we came home from our, let me back up real quick. We were just telling like, hey, we want to see in the morning, like we want to see a leopard or we want to see a lion. Or we want to go see, basically you see the big cats. People want to see the big cats and get all the shots.
This is the dad's photo. Sell out the whole group because they're still inexperienced. So they can be able to, they will easily blow their cover out.
So he would say like, hey, let's go look for, this morning we're gonna go look for the leopard. So we go out, we would drive, I have some shots of us driving around. We did find the leopard. And then when we would come back, we would have either a breakfast or a dinner. And then one night we came back from an evening game drive, they had changed the whole vibe as far as the food. We were eating outside under the starlight.
Yeah, we had a barbecue.
Yeah.
And it's funny because they're very sneaky about it.
Sneaky about it, you know?
They're just
yeah.
like, you make it, it, they make it seem like you're going to like a different part for like a, you know, an additional safari, and they pull into like this little bush area and they have like food set up outside.
And then boom, that's like all of a sudden, oh shoot, we got a barbecue tonight.
What are you going on up tonight?
Barbecue.
No, like, the chef is out there, Bernard is out there, it's like all you can eat.
Yeah.
It's no complaints, man, it was cool.
Yeah.
I think the last thing they got us too was for the bush breakfast.
Oh, our final bush breakfast.
Our final bush breakfast.
Why is everybody out here?
This is
going
to be a breakfast bush.
A breakfast bush on the way out.
Bush with the breakfast.
Bush with the breakfast, man. When do you guys do all this stuff? Oh, wow.
Jumbo.
Jumbo.
Yeah. I mean, it was our final. I don't know everybody else. I don't know what they had going on, but it was our final Bush breakfast, and it was phenomenal. They, you know, had it set up by like a stream, and we're again in the middle of the wild, but you know, they had the food set up. I mean, the food was just so good. Like, this was, he was really a chef.
Yeah,
this
he was a chef.
Chef quality food in the bush.
And he's out there making, he had a skillet, he's frying up eggs, he's making fresh omelets. Like, they had all the food there. We took some pictures. Like, shout out Chef Bernard. If I had enough money, I would fly you out here, cook us some breakfast, but.
Okay.
But for the most part, it was cool.
Yes, they surprised us. We just got off the game drive and they surprised us with this amazing breakfast, home or custom omelets, and just everything is out here. We're in the middle of the bush. I love it.
And it is good. All fresh made omelets.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go.
Please.
Yeah, Kapimski, hands down, it was cool. And finally, before our last, we had, I guess it's called like a sundowner. So on our last game drive, you can go out there, you have some snacks and some food, then you can watch the sunset. And then we had just an all around great, great, great big time. And Dancy's gonna give a little shout out. I'll cut him in here right here. He's gonna just talk about the whole experience at Kapimski.
Yeah.
Jumbo, Jumbo, welcome to Masai Mara. Welcome to Olare Mara Kapimski. Looking forward to an amazing experience. I'll be your guide. Hopefully, we're looking forward to you coming and visit the Masai Mara. Get to experience the bush, get to see how it'll turn out to be. Thank you.
If you haven't done a safari, I say definitely go. Both of them are well, but I would have to say Kapimski was my favorite.
Yeah,
but they both are.
Slept at
yeah,
night.
But they both are a great experience. And also, like I said, when you do, if you do go to Kenya, make sure you plan it. There's a rainy season and there's a dry season. So you don't want to go during the rainy season. I know people want to go through the Great Migration and see all the wildebeest. So we didn't see all that, but I feel like we got our money's worth. We saw everything and no complaints.
And it might seem like with some of this footage, it might seem like we're super close, but the animals, they can't really detect that humans are inside of this vehicle. Because
correct.
Of like the fumes from.
That's what they tell us.
Yeah.
So we won't believe them.
This is the story that they say. And so I'm going to believe it because we didn't get attacked. But I think all in all, there seemed to be a good amount of respect between the animals and the people, and vice versa.
And we felt safe.
Yeah, we felt super safe. There was no danger. And we had a blast. We really had a blast.
Uh-oh.
Okay.
Thank you guys.
You.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you so much. We had such a great time.
Yes.
The food was so
good. The chef right here, this is the magic man.
Bernard.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Chef
Bernard. Thank you.
Welcome.
Okay.
Bye.
Definitely go out there. It was definitely worth it.
Yeah. And I think, you know, it's also like the community of it.
Yeah.
Because you meet so many people from all over the world.
We met a couple from on the 25th wedding anniversary.
Yes,
Lisa and Aaron from Canada. You may see them in some of our shots as well. Shout out to them. But yeah, all in all, it was cool, man. Like, you guys gotta get out there, go to Kenya, check it out, Embu River, Kapimski. Thank you for all that you've done.
Yeah.
You know, we will be dropping more videos, I don't know when. Oh yeah, we got Egypt coming up, huh?
Egypt. Right before this, we went to Egypt.
So y'all stay tuned, make sure you like, subscribe. This will pop up first, and Egypt will be coming up next. And remember to always, what?
Get down with the Browns.
Get down.